Hello, this is Program 7 of the Sewing Connection, Series 6, and I'm Shirley Adams. This is a good year for fringes and time to add a touch to your wardrobe. Perfect candidates for the finish are fabrics which ravel easily or loosely woven fabrics. The Guatemalan skirt that Chrissy's wearing right now was a perfect candidate because it is really a ravelly mess if you don't contain it in some way. Notice on this skirt that it is kind of draped. It's really too stiff a fabric to drape this way, but it is raveled across the front on the hem and it's raveled all around the tie. That means it ravels in all directions around that tie. Some of it's bias, some of it's straight. It's a ravelly fabric is the point I'm making, so it's just the way to go. Now, some of the other things that you might use this ravelly fabric for, and by the way, here it is after I tried to soften it. I put it through the washer several times, and it didn't get any softer, so maybe it isn't too good to make a skirt out of. But anyway, I could see when I was playing with this that, oh, that is a good fringy fabric. Everything else I had, before you put anything like this in the washer, of course, go ahead and serge the edges or stay them in some way so that they aren't going to do this. This was just one little open edge. What this was actually was the scrap and the skirt also. The whole thing was the scrap left over after I had made these belts. And you can see I used some fringing on the belts too because it's such a good ravelly fabric and works so well that way. So accessories that fabric worked well for. Probably for the skirt, there would have been better things to use. Something softer if you're going to drape. But what I did do some fringing then on also is this jacket that's up here on the rack, and it's fringed all the way around the edge. Now, what's nice about so many of these tweeds that we're seeing this year is the fact that they are so colorful. There's everything in them. This particular one could be worn on anybody with any coloring, I think, because of all the colors that are inside. I chose to go with the reds, purples in it, but all of these colors, this odd scarf that has so many colors in, all of those are in this same one. These kind of olive pants, they go with it just very well because that olive is a yarn in here. How about this red blouse underneath? If I can disentangle it, there we go. This red blouse is also in here. We have those same red lines. It's kind of a, well, it's a red. A purple dress here, it goes just as well. I have some purple yarns in there. Even this dress that is so many different colors, I really could wear that under the tweed jacket because it all goes also. I would probably choose to go with the solid instead, but anyway, it is a good way to go so that you can get a lot of mileage out of it and it goes so many different directions in your wardrobe. Here, for instance, on the table is a little sample of that same fabric. And notice what happens if I ravel everything out this way, which is what I'm using as the crosswise. I get all the purple and the red yarns, which are more what I want. My sister, who's in autumn coloring, got the same fabric as we were shopping together one day, and she chose to use hers the other way, and she's going with all these olive rust browns that come out the other direction. So you really could cut this either direction if you're going to fringe it, and what results is because of which way you cut it. Now, the pattern that I used for this, first of all, this asymmetrical cut that I used here, the pattern I used, you've probably seen about 20 other times throughout my series, maybe more than that, because I've used this so much and I just keep cutting it a different way. Here, for instance, is how I cut the left side of this jacket. It was really came out to a point here, the jacket pattern did, but I just folded that point back out of the way. And here's the center front, and I just cut an extra extension for the buttonhole, and then I cut extra for the seam allowance, which in this case turned out into a fringe instead of a seam allowance. But this much extra I cut beyond the center front, and there, this side is pretty much like the pattern, just with the point cut off. The other side, though, I decided I wanted a lapel. This asymmetrical look is kind of nice, and this lapel actually buttons up if you want to. Up here, there's a button, or it can just be worn open, which I will probably do since I decorated the other side of it. But with this, it was just taking this same pattern, and I put a piece of notebook paper on and folded it back and decided, yes, this is about the shape I want. I'll just go ahead and pin this in place here and show you how it is the very same as the jacket. You can change these patterns so easily to your liking to make something different. Once you have, I keep telling you, once you have that suit pattern altered so that it fits you, get some mileage out of it, wear it several times. But here's what this side is. It just has this extra little fly here that then folds back for the lapel. So that's simple. Change the pattern whenever you want to. I keep reminding you also, you're the designer. Do as you please and find some of these fun details that you can do. Well, with this fabric that fringes so easily, that ravels so easily, here's how I started on it. I decided, for one thing, it would be foolish to put standard seams around the edge of this jacket, because if I did, that would just be bulky. To put seams around and then stitch on a separate fringe, that would be silly to do that. So here's the way I did it instead. I have my layers of fabric today, or together here, and let's say this is what goes around the lapel. It swings out here. This is the lapel that folds open. Notice what I've done when I put the fusible interfacing here. Instead of putting it right out to the edge of the fabric, as I probably would with fusibles if I would be doing standard seams around the edge, with this, I cut these all maybe 5/8 inch short, maybe even a little bit more if you want plenty of fringe there and don't want any of that interfacing showing. So I fuse that to the jacket and then put the facing on top and stay stitch the two around, and then you can do the fringing. Now think about the way you cut this facing also, because when this is all done here, and I'll put it down on the table so you can see what I'm talking about. When this is all finished, I have two layers actually of fringe here. I have both the facing layer coming out here, and I also have the front layer coming out. So I probably could part this right down the middle with a comb and open it up, but there are two distinct layers here. What you might want to do with these two distinct layers is take advantage of the colors that you get from either direction, from both directions, by cutting the facing crosswise and the jacket lengthwise, for instance. Then I wouldn't get just all this red-purple. I would get one layer of the red-purple, and I would get the other layer of the bronze rusties and so on. I would get all those layers together. I didn't. I cut both mine the same directions, and that's why when this is raveled, that's why I have all the red purple down the front and all the more autumn colors down on the bottom. But think in advance, play a little with the scrap, see what happens when you ravel out, and decide accordingly how you're going to cut it out before you actually do the cutting. Well, these are cut, let me see, in the same direction in two different directions. These are cut in two different directions that I have on this sample. So that means after I stay stitch this together and do a little fringing, I'm going to have that combination of colors. So this is just, and I'm going to use contrasting threads so that if you need to, for any reason, you can see what I have done. I'm just resetting the machine. I had it on something else. Okay, just a standard seam is all we need here, 5/8 around the edges. And if this is very bulky, tweed, as some of them are this year. They're quite bulky. Big, heavy winter coat type tweeds. If that's the case, you might even want to lessen the pressure a little bit so that it doesn't scoot when you do this. Come on, one more. Thank you. Okay. So, after we get this stitched, then you can see how easy it is to ravel. I'm not going to throw away all these ravelings. I'm going to use them so that they're important to me. And once we have all this pin out, and you can see then how easy this is to pull these yarns out. They just come right out very, very easily. So you can see why it's such a good candidate. Now with most wools this way, wool fibers, if you look at them under a microscope, have overlapping scales. So they kind of want to cling. So right on the edge, it's easy to ravel out. But as you get in there a little bit, then it becomes more difficult and you have to work a little harder with it. Whereas some fabrics, the synthetics in particular, are so slippery that they'll just almost fall apart. They'll come out very easily. But you can see now that I'm off the edge and in there just a little bit, it's a little bit more difficult to do. What I'm raveling out are these autumn colors now, so it goes this direction. If I would go to the other layer and ravel some out, then I'd get the other colors. So I'll get a couple of those. And what I'm going to use these yarns for then, after they're all out, is to couch on the over my stay stitch line and a few more rows. It's going to be like a trim, and it's going to look like trims that you could probably buy, but you could never match them as well as you can by just raveling out your yarns. I'll ravel some on the other corner too. Boy, they start easily, and they just don't stay that easy then. I have really no scraps left over of this because I needed a lot of these yarns, so all the scraps I had, I just raveled to the bare nubs until I had all the scraps I wanted to use and almost nothing left for the framework. Okay, well anyway, you can see how quickly this goes. Any place where I had bias areas, which I did around the neck here, this was bias as it curved here around the neck, that took a little bit more doing. I didn't actually pull any of the yarns out there. What I did there was take a tapestry needle, that blunt needle, and with that tapestry needle, because I didn't want to actually catch any of those yarns and pull them apart, with that tapestry needle, though, I could just unravel them, and they all stayed on here. Now, when I unraveled them here around the neck, some of them turned out a little bit longer, depending on how the angle was at which it was cut. Some of them were longer, some of them were shorter. So after I unraveled all these, and here especially, you can see this was bias where I have a mixture of colors. I have both the warm and the cool colors all together here. But in this area, some of them were kind of long. Just gave it a haircut then afterwards, after it was all raveled, so that it would all turn out the same size, the same length. Okay, then after you have those raveled, and I'm just saving, I'm not saving these yarns at all. Maybe I'll send those to my sister who needed the other colors. But these are the yarns that I wanted. And so with these, I'm going to decide how exactly I can get those on the jacket to decorate it. Now here's some that I've already raveled, and you can see what I have left here. I took everything. Now I have kind of a lacy fabric left. I might even use this for something. But anyway, what I have done is pull out all the purples, all the heavy reds, and I just have a framework left. When I get inside, instead of pulling it off the edge, then when you get inside here, you simply pull whatever yarn you want and kind of, like you're gathering it up, kind of pull it out that way is the way you do it if you want any of that fabric left. If I wanted to do a quicker job, I also didn't hesitate to, when the going got tough, when it wouldn't really ravel out easily, then just cut off some of it so that you're again on an edge and then it ravels out easily since you have the edge here instead of the interior. So get the yarns whatever way is feasible and you're ready to go. Now my first thought was using a 7-hold foot to do this couching. I've used it before on other programs, but it does some wonderful things. Here's what this little 7-hole foot looks like. It actually has 7 holes in it, and I then have used, as I have here, with those 7 different colors of pearl cotton in this case, and then you just stitch down whatever decorative stitch, or maybe just a zigzag stitch over them, but whatever you want to use, you stitch right over them. Now these are easy to get through those holes if you have a needle threader. You do need that because you can't just thread these through all that easily. So any of these yarns, one at a time, I'll just pull out one of them. Any of these I would pull through by threading it through this needle threader. If I can hold on to it here, there we go. And if you don't have one of these, you can find them in the drugstore, in the toothpaste department, the dental things. Okay, so anyway, you can see that it does pull through very easily this way. Well, this is how I started out doing my heavy wool yarns also. And I found out, no, it doesn't work with these because they're too heavy, too nubby, and as I was stitching over them, some of them, every time it would come to a nub, it would kind of get hung up there and it wouldn't really work well. So I found out that that's only for smooth yarns or threads or cords or whatever it is. It is only for smooth things. It's not for these heavy, nubby ones. So I tried it just with the regular multi-purpose foot and found, no, that didn't work well either because they would come up in that middle space, that broken space, and they wouldn't stay in place as well. So just get some sort of a foot that you have that has a bar all the way across to hold it. Because you want these to be flat, you probably don't want to use a cording foot since it would clump them all together in the middle. So what I'm using is just a foot that has a bar going across the center, so it'll hold all those yarns flat when I use several of them. But there is a little space underneath. There's an indentation, and it will allow for that extra heaviness, so it'll work well. Either this or there's a clear foot I have, either one would work just fine. And I'll get this thread out of the way, and I'll put a few of these yarns through it and then do some couching. I couch this in different groups. Here I already have some that's done that I was playing with to see how it would work. And you can do several at a time, maybe four or five yarns at a time. And it's just a matter of getting them all in here, getting them in between there. I have them in, and I'm going to then put them, I have them in way too far. I really wanted them on this end. I'll just pull them out again and start over. Okay, I want them down here, so I'll just get a little bit of that inside and toward the back. Okay, and once that's in place, then I'll put the fabric under. I might as well use this one that I've just stitched before and raveled out a little bit and show you on this exactly how it works. You decide on what the decorative stitch is going to be then. Okay, this first row I'm going to put near my stay stitching so I can cover it up because it really wasn't terribly pretty since it was contrasting threads and not even matching threads. I might try something that is really covered over and see what it does. And I have a feeling that, oh, here's a little honeycomb thing. I have a feeling that it'll cover over too much and it won't show the, see how this really is covering up, it's going back and forth. And because it's covering up so much, it isn't moving fast enough. So that is not a good choice. Let's instead do something that's just sort of a curvy line that goes back and forth and see what this looks like. And it's still closer than it needs to be. Let's make those stitches longer and let's make them as wide as they'll go so it covers all the yarns. Okay, by the time I have this going bigger now, the yarns will show more, the sewing thread will show less, bigger still. That's as big as it wants to go, that little beep told me. Okay. We can live with that. When you get to the corner, stop in the outside corner. Couple more stitches. There we go. Stop there and turn the corner. Get all those yarns adjusted because probably on the inner corner here, I'll have to pull those a little tighter. And then just keep going beyond that. And anyway, very easy to do. You would, of course, do it with matching thread instead of this white contrast that I'm just doing so that you can see it. And so it turns out to be real pretty. Well, I did first of all the pinks and purples, and then I thought, that doesn't have enough punch. So I found to combine some of the red with it, because it clashes a little bit with it, that's what punched it up and made it look a whole lot better. Gave it a little bit more, brought attention to it. So once this is all couched on, it really does look like some sort of a purchased braid. So you can always do this, put yarns on. You can always do this with a really good match instead of combing all the stores and trying to find something. Then after you have this couching done to your satisfaction, whatever it is you're going to do about it, you might want to put some buttonholes in as I did. And I thought, well, this is very ravelly fabric, but it's all being held together very nicely with the couching, with the interfacing, with the stay stitching, so I ought to be able to put some buttonholes in. So let's see how a buttonhole looks in this. And I'll just get this out of the way and put a buttonhole right next to it. So let's get a different foot on for a buttonhole. And let's push a button and we can have a buttonhole, and it's kind of heavy fabric. No, it's kind of medium woven fabric, and I'll just push a buttonhole and see what they select for me. So I'm going to put this buttonhole kind of close. In fact, what I did on my jacket and what I have on this other sample is I have it bordering the couched yarns that I have there, so everything's kind of close. But okay, let's do a buttonhole here and see how it's going to look. And even though I have rather large buttons on my jacket, it was probably about an inch and an eighth buttonhole. I'll just make kind of a short one here. And then we'll cut that buttonhole open. Now, I think a lot of people make kind of ugly buttonholes, not because of their machine, but because of the way they cut it open. So here's a little a neat little gadget that you can find in any shop in the notions department. It's instead of scissors or instead of using a ripper to open that buttonhole, how about using a chisel? And if you just use this little chisel, this might make your buttonhole look a whole lot nicer. Because if you use a ripper, for instance, or scissors, you know how you might catch some of those threads? With this chisel, you just put it right down here. It's very thin. It is not going to hit the threads at all. You just put it right down there between your thread lines. Give it a little push. I put that wood block underneath so that it won't ruin the table. And it cuts a buttonhole beautifully, and it probably will do a much better job. So try one of these and see if that doesn't do it a little bit easier. Well, couch the yarns on, do some fun things with them. And then after you get finished with all that, it might be time to do a little decorating. I had extra yarns, and I thought, okay, what else would I like? This is fine when I button it up at the neck. But also, if I open it up, which is probably how I'll wear it most of the time, those yarns just seem to ask to be made into a flower. So here we have a little flower. Now, you can come up with something very nice. I didn't try my ingenuity too hard. What I did was take a group of yarns like this, and I'll put a few more with them, maybe use all these. And I just worked these around into a little flower. So this flower that I have has, maybe about 4 or 5 petals on it. Very simple little one. So that's just a matter of arranging this yarn like so, and then make it into another petal here. And I have short enough yarns here, it just might be a 3-leaf clover instead of a 4. Maybe not. Maybe I can get a little more out of it. Okay, well anyway, it was just doing something about like this. Now, this could be done, of course, very, very easily on machine, but because I really didn't want it to show to the right side, since I would wear it closed, possibly also, I didn't do it on machine. You'd have to do this before you put the two layers together if you wanted to do it on machine, and that would be an impossibility because you need those two layers together right off the bat in order to do the yarn couching around them. So I put this on by hand. So it was just taking a few hand stitches to get it down in place. I'll put it on one of these samples. Okay, just working so that none of those threads would show, and taking a few stitches here and there. A very simple little process. Okay, and just whatever holds it down. Going through the one layer only. And after this layer is all on, the flower in place. Get it really secure there because you don't want it pulled off as you wear it and as jewelry touches it or whatever. So, a few easy stitches. This was a really easy jacket. You know how when you do regular tailoring, all these enclosed edges here are going to take you a lot of time to really grade them well. Grading, remember, is cutting each of those layers a different size so that there is no sharp line of demarcation, so that there is no ridge on the edge, so that it really looks flat and smooth and professional. Well, this is a whole lot easier. This is something for either medium capabilities, or maybe it's something for all of you experienced people who just want to do a quick job. To leave these edges open and ravel them like that, it's so much quicker than doing the actual tailoring way of grading the edges and having regular seams. Well, anyway, after I had this whole thing on, then it's time to put some centers in that flower. And what I did for centers, I just had some little seed beads that look like this. I think they're some kind of seeds. I don't know what they are. But anyway, these little seeds do have holes in the middle of them. And I found you actually can put this on by machine if you want to. And so since that's the case, I'm just going to put a standard foot back on. And the way you'd put this on by machine is just set it on buttonhole. And lower the feed teeth so that they aren't in the way, so that they won't make it progress. And put just a regular multi-purpose foot on because they're so tiny. Very often you sew buttons on with no foot whatsoever by just putting the presser bar down. But with these beads, because they are so tiny and won't hold very well like they would a button, it's a good idea to have a foot there maybe. But I actually could put this down and put a bead on top, and it's going to get buried in this heavy flower. I'll put it off to the side just so you can see more easily. But you actually can do this, but I'm going to get a flatter one. Okay, here's one. It's a little bit. No, it's not.
Here's one a little bit flatter. Okay. Also, what I'm looking for is one that has a hole that's big enough that it's actually going to go through. The needle is. Okay, there we've got it through. So once it's through, put the foot down, and then you can just step on the pressure, the presser foot, and see how it just goes back and forth off the bead, on the bead, and you actually can stitch this by machine. Now here again, I don't really want to stitch this one by machine because, just as with the other one, I've got my flower caught, okay, just as with the other one, because I don't want that thread to go all the way through to the outside, so I actually did these by hand. But you can see how easy this is. Once you get it on by machine, there's no reason why you couldn't just tip it up and put a whole lot of those on in a really big hurry. So, kind of a fun little jacket, kind of an easy one. If you have extra raveled out yarns that you want to use for something else, put them on a sweater, make a shaggy vest, do something else with them. But it's a good year for fringing, so let's do a little fringing and see what you can do that looks different, that perks up your wardrobe. Well, many designer lines seem to have a fringe here or there, so why not try this different touch on something in your closet? Not only do designer clothes have unusual accents, but also they mysteriously feel better. They fit better when you wear them. Want to know why? Come join us next time when Sandra Betzina, syndicated sewing columnist, shows you some designer secrets for easier wearing.